We're so thankful for all you moms out there and both here with us in the sanctuary and those who are online. And let's just take a moment. I want us to pray for all of our moms. I know my mom is tuning in with this online live. And so, Mom, happy Mother's Day. I already called you earlier, but I'll say it from here. Happy Mother's Day. And then to my wife of my kids, happy Mother's Day. And to all you moms, happy Mother's Day. Can we do this? Can we just take a moment? Let's pray for all the mothers. In fact, this morning, can we recognize you? Would you mind standing? And we just want to recognize all the moms in the house this morning, all across. Come on, let's give them a big round of applause. We are so thankful for you, moms. If you'll remain standing just for a moment, let's stretch our hands out and let's pray for all these moms. Lord, we thank you, Father, for your goodness. Lord, we thank you for moms in our life. We thank you, Father, for their heart. Lord, as moms represent the nurturing, the heart of God and the nurturing of God, Father, in our lives. I pray, Lord, that you just bless every mother here. Lord, that you would continue to grace them, adorn them with your beauty, Father. And I thank you, Lord, for every virtuous woman in this house, Father. And I thank you, Lord, Father, for their faithfulness, Lord, for their patience, for their kindness, Lord, for their gentleness. And I praise you, Lord, Father, for even their boldness, Lord, to snatch us up in those times when we need to be snatched up, but also in those times, Lord, when they help nurture us and comfort us through times of hurt and sorrow. Lord, I pray, Lord, you'll bless every mother, Lord, both here present with us today and, Lord, those who are online. I pray, Lord, that today would be a day of celebration, of honoring them and the role they play in our lives, in our communities. And I pray, Lord, that you bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, today, as we come together, Lord, to worship you, Father, and as we've already lifted our voices, Lord, today, we pray, Lord, that you bless the word this morning. Father, may our hearts be open to receive, our eyes open to see, and Lord, that our ears be open to hear, and our hearts open to receive and to respond to the truth of your word, and we give you the praise for it. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Moms, you may be seated. Thank you so much. If you got your Bible, go ahead and turn to 1 Samuel chapter 1 this morning. And I tend not to preach messages for the holiday as much, but this morning I really want to. I just had a heart, and I want to share some traits that we find that we see from a mom. In fact, I've titled this message, A Praying Mom. For many of you in this room, you may not be here today if it wasn't for a praying mom or type in your life. I remember my dad would testify often about how it was because of his mom who was praying for him and continued to demonstrate living a life model before him that is the reason why not only did he get saved, but also why he helped to lead to get saved, but also what helped him to continue to pursue ministry and live a life that he did was because of the faithfulness that he saw in his mom towards the Lord. And many of you in this room probably could testify of the same. And as we think about our mothers, there's many different traits that we see. We see from some of us, we may have came from a single parent home where the mom was the one who raised us and the mom was the one who poured in our lives, who corrected us, who disciplined us, and who helped us and maybe still does in life now. Some of you may came from, you may have multiple moms or representatives of moms in your lives. And in that, that place today, though, is I want to look at the mom of a mom who's a believer and the heart of a praying mom. I remember both with my grandmother, then also my mom, years of watching them mentor or model before me a life of prayer, a life dedicated. I remember with my mom at many hours in the night, late hours, early hours in the morning, her praying for us kids. And whenever ones of us would do unwise things or act foolish, she was the one who was praying on our behalf. I remember living with my grandmother for a season. And whenever I was living with her, I remember every morning I'd wake up to her out in her sunroom reading the Bible and praying. And there's some things that I learned watching both their lives, but then also what I see with the scripture of a particular mother who had a heart of prayer. And today I want us to look at this, and here's the truth. No matter what perspectives you have, no matter, there's six truths I want to give you today of this illustration that we see in scripture about how we can apply it to our lives. Whether you're a mom or not, these six truths apply in every aspect of your life. I want you to catch this first and foremost, that God calls us all to a life of prayer. That as a believer, in fact, it's just expected out of us. It's not something that is per se I don't want to say it's per se commanded. However, we are charged to pray, But it's expected our life. Out of our communion with God and as we fellowship, we begin to develop a communication with God, which is called prayer. And oftentimes in our circles and in communities of faith, it's easy for us to think of prayer as something way more than what it actually is. Prayer is simply this. If you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. Prayer is simply communication with God. And prayer demands two things. One, it demands that we speak up and talk to God. But two, it demands that we also get quiet and listen to God. Simple as that. Oftentimes we may say, well, I don't know how to pray. Well, you know what? God even gave a solution for that. He said, well, you don't know how to pray, let the Holy Spirit pray on your behalf with groanings which you do not know of. And so we see that God, that this issue of prayer is very important to God. And listen, I want men in the room, y'all listen to me. Prayer is not just reserved for women. Oftentimes it's modeled by women in the church. But listen, God calls us all to pray and to a life of prayer. In fact, to a point of even what's called intercessory prayer. And that's when we pray on the behalf of others. I want you to see this in scripture. It's in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Paul's writing to him and he's encouraging and interceding for others. He says, therefore, I exhort first of all that supplication, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that they may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all goodness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. It's God's heart that we would be people of prayer, that we would engage in prayer, that we would just by nature as a believer in the likeness of Christ, that we would just with an instinct have a desire to fellowship with God himself, to commune with him. In fact, let me take it all the way back to this for you. This morning, as believers in this house, and those of you who are online with us, as a believer, the whole purpose of the cross of your salvation is that you could be reunited in right fellowship with God, that you can commune with him. Let me say like this, that you can converse with him. In fact, here's the beauty. We see this is that after Jesus died on the cross, we find out that the veil to the temple was rent, that it was torn. Meaning this is that all of a sudden, no longer do we have to come to God through a high priest, but now we go through Jesus, our one high priest. Amen. And now we can for eternity come before God because of he that is in us and because we are washed in his blood. Come on, somebody. And because of that, now we have the joy and the privilege to get to have fellowship with God and to have communion with God, to have conversation with God, prayer. And so you know what? There should be just a natural desire. You know, and I get it. I understand when you first get saved, there's those feelings of, man, I don't feel righteous. I feel maybe shamed in my past, maybe all those things. But listen, friend, Jesus once and forever ever settled that. So therefore, you are made righteous through Christ Jesus who loved us first. Therefore, you can come before God. Scripture says boldly. Boldly you can come before him. You can call upon Father God and call out to his name. You can ask of him. You can require. You can ask. You can beckon of him. You can desire. But listen, you can even come and just fellowship with him. And I want to encourage you today, if anything that you get out of this message today, I pray this, is that today that your prayer life would just be ignited a little bit. That it would be turned a little bit, that today maybe they'll be put a little in your giddy up to say, man, I want to spend some time with God. And here's the beautiful thing, friend. Scripture says that when we call up him, he'll hear us when we pray, that he won't turn us away sorrowfully. I want you to think about this. In Hebrews chapter 7, Jesus even said and or showed the importance of intercession, of intercessory prayer where we're praying on behalf of others. He said this in verse 25 of chapter 7. Therefore, he, Jesus, is also able to save the utmost those who come to God through him, since he, Jesus, always lives to make intercession for them. Even Jesus is at the right hand of the Father interceding on our behalf. Those who are far from God, he's praying on their behalf. And even us, the Holy Spirit continues to pray over and over and again for our protection, for guidance, for wisdom in our life. And friend, I want to encourage you, but not only that, there's a place of our life where we're called to be ones who intercede. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 14, we see where this is where it says, now this is the confidence that we have in him, in Jesus, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we will have the petitions that we have asked of him. Man, what a beautiful promise that whatever we ask of God when we come before him, listen, according to his will, there's a place of knowing that we can rest assured that as we call on him, he hears our prayer and he responds to our petitions. I want to encourage you to be people of prayer. Man, I want to encourage you, man, to pray with fervency, to pray with passion, to pray with simplicity. The place of recognizing that you don't have to come with thous and these and those and thuses, but you can come before God simply with a heart yielding and bent towards him in humility, honoring him as Father God. And he not only bringing your burdens and your cares and even the concerns of others through intercessory prayer, but friend, you can also come before him with an open ear to hear what the Father wants to say to you. Now, I want to tell you something. I say this often. I believe this with all my heart. God is a God who affirms. He's an affirming Father. And one of the most powerful things that you could ever do is learn not only to share with God, but to receive from God. And learn to open your ear, open up your spiritual ears. What does that mean, Pastor? It means this, just get quiet before the Lord. Said, Lord, what do you want to say? Listen, if you look, he always speaks. He's always speaks. His word is always speaking to us. And as we get into his scripture and get quiet before him, and all of a sudden he begins to share what's called rhema word, his living word, but in that moment it speaks to a place in our life. And all of a sudden it illuminates, and all of a sudden our lives are refreshed and encouraged. But see, I believe this is not only God will he give his imparted word and his rhema word, but I believe that he will speak also a spiritual word in your life that's in accordance to his written word. Amen? And so I want to encourage us, man, let's be people of prayer. In fact, in scripture, we see this of a mom who had a heart's desire for a son. In fact, we read in 1 Samuel of this mother who, man, she was married to this man and she had this great desire to have a child. And every year when it come time for the sacrifice, the father would go and he would prepare him. Scripture tells us in 1 Samuel chapter 1 that this dad would go and he would make plans for sacrifice, but he would always give for part of his family. He would give their make sacrifice for her and their sons. But for this particular wife, Hannah, scripture says he had a great love for her. And in fact, he would give a double portion on her part. But for some reason, that wasn't enough. You know what that's interesting to me? I want you to think about this. You know, oftentimes in life, we want the possessions of this world. We like new cars. We like new bags, we like new shoes, we like new clothes, and there's things that we crave, but you know what? There's something that I see here very right off the bat about this story that relates very well to each and every one of us. There was something that this mother craved that her womb, scripture says, was shut off, and so it would require a miracle from God. It would require something from God for her to receive the very great desire of her heart, and that was her own son. Scripture tells us that she petitioned God, that she went before the Lord and was crying out. In fact, we pick this up in chapter 1, verse 9, if you'll go with me there in 1 Samuel. It says, so Hannah arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on the seat of the door of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the afflictions of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. Man, what an incredible cry. What an incredible prayer. This woman with a desire in her heart to be a mother, to be one that God would use to raise up another. But it's interesting is that her heart's desire was this, and her deep desire of receiving a son. Her promise to God was this, God, if you give me a son, I'll give him to you. He'll serve you. I wonder sometimes if the desire of Hannah was greater than the fact of the call of the gift that she wanted rather than the gift that she would receive. I wonder within her life if she recognized that the her place, or if already her position was this, is that she would glorify her master with everything of her life. We see this within, I think, the nature of how she was towards her husband. There's a reason why he loved her so much and why he would give her double portion. There was a reason why. And I think because of the nurturing of her heart, a position to serve those who she served under. And ultimately, Almighty God in a position where she said, God, I want to give you everything I have, but I so long to be with child and to have a son. Out of this story, I want to go through and kind of dissect these next few passages. And I want to point out to you six power principles to learn from a praying mother. Right off the bat, we see the position of her heart. And we see this, number one, that we must learn to take it to the Lord. Everybody say, take it to the Lord. This place within our life and there are circumstances in our life, and no matter whether if it's something that you desire or something that you're going through or situation in life, friend, I want to tell you something. God is a good God. He's got his ears open to us. He's listening. He longs to fellowship. But here's a promise. You can take it to him. He's one that is trustworthy. That no matter whether if it's a desire in the heart or if it's a concern on the mind, you can take it to the Lord. Look what happens here in verse 10. As she went before the Lord, scripture tells us this, as she was with bitterness of soul. She had a deep longing. She had a great desire. It says, and prayed to the Lord and wept with anguish. She knew that the place, the only one who could satisfy the need, the only one who could satisfy the longing would be Almighty God. And the place that she did, she went to the Lord. Second thing in this, if you're taking notes, is this. Pray for his will to be done. Pray for his will to be done. Oftentimes within our prayers, we pray very self-centered. It's always, let me say it like this. Oftentimes our prayers are geared based upon our current need and basically our current of what we need to get out of. God, I need help. But whenever there's victory in our life, when things are going good, do we praise him for that? Do we go to him and say, God, how can I extend this blessing to others? God, what can I do with what you've done in my life? But it's very easy for us when we're in trouble that we very first and foremost run to God to look for him to try to bail us out. I heard somebody this week, I can't remember what was that. They were talking about with kids doing with their schoolwork and stuff like that, and said something about the standpoint that all of a sudden they go and they ask, for it might have been Pastor Cameron Wednesday night. They may talking about asking God for whenever, trying to do a test coming up and praying, saying, God, you haven't studied, you haven't prepared, you hung out, played video games all week, then all of a sudden, test day shows up and you begin to intercede. Dear God, help me today to automatically learn and know everything that I have not studied or have taught myself in this time. Right? And out of it, we expect God's just all this supernatural going to pop the answers in my mind. Yes, Lord, I hear you. C. Yes, Lord, I hear you. D. Right? Listen, as long as there's tests in schools, there will still be prayer in school. Amen? But out of it, that's oftentimes our nature, how we are. Is that, man, we run to God when we're in need of something. But friend, whenever we learn to position for the place and come before him, saying, God, I come to you for what's your will in my life? What's your will during this situation? I wonder how oftentimes things would play out differently if we surrendered simply to the will of God from the very beginning. That is good. Come on, somebody. Man, that when our life is a position saying, God, I want to walk in your will. And listen, to know the will of God requires two things. Actually, three. It requires knowing this, prayer, and faith. And out of that place, not trying to make it complicated. It's not that you've got to become a theologian. Listen, it's simply this. Daily spend time where you just begin to get this in you. And spend and develop a life of prayer when you come before the Lord and, Not to where you're praying 24 hours in English out loud. And no, scripture says that we should pray continually without ceasing. But speaking about the Spirit of God, praying on our behalf and our minds being cast on, being thought towards the Lord and a place of a heart bent towards God's will. But the place of prayer, whenever we develop a life of prayer, is a place that whether if it's through victory, through times of drought, or through times of sorrow, we always position our heart to come before the Lord for him to lead us, to guide us, to walk us in all situations. Amen? One, we take it to the Lord. Two, we pray his will. God, what's your will? Look what she did in verse 11. Then she made a vow and said to the Lord, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look upon the afflictions of your maid. God, if it's your desire, if you so will, would you look upon the afflictions of your maid servant? And my heart said, her desire. There's nothing wrong with you expressing your desires. God wants to satisfy your desires. But listen, as we get close to him, he'll begin to reveal your needs. And then all of a sudden, your desires will come in line with his will. Come on, somebody. And they'll begin to be fulfilled, because what he wants to do both in you, he'll prepare. He'll heal, restore, and he'll prepare you and set you in a position to begin to use you to do great and mighty things. Listen, sometimes the great and mighty things being, we take it, say it like this in our church, to make a difference. Listen, sometimes that's simply this, to make a difference in your kids' lives, make a difference in your family, make a difference in your place of work, make a difference in your church, make a difference in your community. But when we position our heart towards him and come along with his will. The third thing is this, trust the Lord. What does that mean? Simply this, have faith. Trust him. Say, God, I'm going to trust you in this. That means that the moment we come before him and we give it over, or we come in agreement with him, we don't walk away, change our mind, and take the reins. Come on, somebody. Look what happened in verse 13. I want you to look at this. Verse 13. It says this. Now Hannah spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, he's the high priest, he's the priest. He said, how long will you be drunk? Put your wine away from you. But Hannah answered and said, no, my Lord, I'm a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor intoxicating drink, but have poured out my heart and my soul before the Lord. We see this place where her heart's cry is saying, I have put my trust in God. I'm not drunk. I've just made a decision. I've positioned myself to say, God, I'm trusting you no matter what. Proverbs tells us this. Trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he shall direct your paths. What a beautiful promise that we can look to the Lord and say, God, I want to trust you. No matter what things look like, no matter how bad my kids act up, no matter how hard my marriage is, no matter how great things are, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to choose to trust your promise. I'm going to choose to follow your word. Even though it don't make sense now, I'm going to trust you. I want you to look at this, the fourth thing that she did. Not only did she bring her supplication to the Lord and intercede on behalf of the desire of her heart, but she prayed for his will to be done. She trusted him, but listen, she also stood on his word. Friend, I want to tell you something. There's something about the word of God. This promise is yes and amen. It is so. And when we learn this, is that we can trust him at his word. When he says, cross the Jordan, guess what? We can cross the Jordan. When he says, get in the boat, go to the other side. It doesn't matter what storms rise up. It doesn't matter how big the waves begin to roll over. It doesn't matter how much lightning is in the sky. When we trust him at his word, and when we stand on his word, we go, it doesn't matter. We're not gonna die because he told us to go to the other side. He's already commanded us for go, so he's gonna pave the way. Amen? Stand on his word. Matthew 4, 24, verse 35. says heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. 1 Peter 1:25, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Psalms 89 verse 2, I will declare that your love stands firm forever and that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. Psalms 119, 88, in your unfailing love preserve my life that I may obey the statutes of your mouth. Psalms 119, 152, long ago I learned from your statutes that you established them to last forever. Psalms 119, 160, all your words are true. All your righteous laws are eternal. Isaiah 40 verse 8, the grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of God endures forever. Friend, I want to tell you something. You may be not able to stand upon the things of this promise is this. The things of this earth are going to pass away. When things are shaken, the things established by man are going to falter. But friend, if you establish your life upon the word of God, it will not be shaken. Come on, somebody. Hannah made a decision to stand on the word of God that was given by the man of God. Look what happens in verse 17. Then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition which you have asked of him. The word of God went forth, and listen, something happened. Hannah didn't remain in a place of sorrow and crying, oh, if you could just give me a son. That's where she was. It transitioned to she got up, dusted off the dust from where she was, and began to walk in the faith that she had in God. And as the man of God spoke the word of God in her life, she began to walk in peace and walked knowing that God was going to fulfill his promise. What happens if we, the church, would do that? What happens if, as we pray, as we petition God, we hear his word, and we simply just walk in it? What would be the outcome? What would be the outcome? What would be the outcome of our individual lives if we would simply just take him at his word? Not falter from it. Not try to take the reins and control things. But simply say, God, I look to you and you're in full control. You know what? This world would look at you and think that you're drunk. They'd look at you and think you're crazy. They'd look at you and say, what are you on? But friend, I want to tell you something. When you walk with God, you walk in his peace. You walk in his joy. You walk in the fulfillment of life that only he can give. There's a reason why the man of God spoke to her, and Eli told her, said, go in peace. Don't walk anymore with this weightiness on your life. No, you walk in the peace of God. You go. Hey, look what he said. I love this. May the God of Israel grant your petition. That which you've called out, may he grant that in your life. Fifth thing, if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. We got to learn to leave it on the altar. The very things, whenever we come before God and we pray and we petition and we call us and God, I need you in this area. What, no matter what it is, we need to learn that when we meet with God, leave it at the altar. When we walk away in victory. We walk away in peace. We walk away knowing that God will move on our behalf. Trust in him. Taking him at his very word. Look what she did in verse 18. And she said, let your maidservant find favor in your sight. So the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. She left it at the altar. After she spent time with God, she trusted him. Listen, she took it to the Lord. She prayed his will to be done. She trusted him. She took him at his word. She left it at the altar. And the last thing is this, if you're taking notes, she gave him all the praise. See, here's the key thing, and I believe this is a crucial part. Oftentimes, we wait for the victory or we wait for the answer prayer before we ever give God thanks for the answer. One of the things I learned, I actually learned this from my father-in-law, Pat Stevens. One time we were praying, and it was actually praying for somebody. We was at I think it was a family member. We was at a hospital praying for him. I'll never forget when Pat sat there and we prayed and asked the Lord And I'll never forget, he turned and said, now let's thank the Lord for answering our prayer. And my initial thought was, we haven't got it yet. But why did we pray in the first place? Because we had faith that God would do it. And so our place and position, our heart was, God, now we're going to praise you for answering. Even though our eyes, our physical eyes may not see it, even though in the presence it's not here. You know what, with Hannah, she hadn't received her son yet. She had come before the Lord, she had prayed. She longed, she wept, she trusted. She left at the altar trusting that God heard her petition, that God would do what he said he would do, and walked in peace, left for that place, walking in the promise of God. Look at verse 19, what happened? It says, then they arose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord and returned and came to their house at Ramah. Listen, the position of our heart was this. God, I've let you know my circumstance. God, I've come with my petition. You know, you hear, I trust you. You got this. So now my position is this. I'm going to thank you for the outcome. I'm going to thank you for answering my prayer. I'm going to thank you, and I'm going to praise you louder than anybody else. As loud as I wept, now I'm going to praise you and glorify you and rejoice. For you're the promise keeper. You're the one who answers prayer. And you're the one who is faithful to the end. Amen? I want to encourage you, church. Let's be people of prayer. Man, let's be people that not only cry out to God and bring through prayer and petition, but let's be ones who also, out of that place, that we worship God in spite of what we see, but based in what we believe. That we trust him and we glorify him for he's faithful. Look what happens. I'll end with this. Scripture tells us this is that as Elkanah, her husband, knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. Verse 20. So it came to pass in the process of time that Hannah conceived and bore a son and called his name Samuel, saying, because I have asked for him from the Lord. Many of you know, Samuel became a mighty man of God. And she gave her son back to the Lord and brought him as she promised, said, Lord, if you'll give him to me, I'll return him to you. What an incredible gift to give to the Lord. Your child, your firstborn. Today, we continue to model after the life of Hannah. With children, we do what's called baby dedication, where we come and we bring our babies to the Lord and we dedicate them in the same manner, saying, Lord, you blessed us. Now we come before you to commit before you and before our congregation, these children. It all came out of a place of petition, of a desire and longing in a heart, but ultimately a place of prayer. One who believed that only God could and chose to trust him. What an incredible thing to trust God with a life. You know what? It's the same thing for each and every one of us. That even though we may not be praying and asking God for maybe a baby, but you know what? Every one of us long that God will preserve life. And many of you in this room, man, at one point you made a prayer, you made a decision, you prayed a prayer, and you by faith received Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, that you could walk in fellowship with God. And listen, from the very beginning, you began with prayer. Think about it. As a believer, the very first thing we encourage you to walk in fact, the very first thing that you're called to is prayer. Where you believe in your heart, and Scripture says you confess with your mouth, repent of your sins, but you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Wow, a prayer. And from that very moment on, you begin a conversation, a journey, a life of living with Almighty God, trusting him every day of your life. And daily communion with him. James writes, and he makes a statement, I want you to catch this. He says, is anyone among you suffering? Is anybody hurting? Is anybody afflicted? Is anybody going through pain? Does anybody have questions? Man, does anybody, man, do you have worry? Do you have doubt? Do you have concern? Let him pray. Do you feel lost? You feel without hope? Let him pray. Listen to the other side of this. Is anyone cheerful? Man, are you full of joy? Have you received hope? Have you received life? Look what he says. Let him sing psalms. See, out of your life, there's a position where everything is always going before the Lord. Where we can come before him with prayer and petition, or we can come before him with songs of thanksgiving, declaring his goodness and thanking for what he's done. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I would ask you today, friend, maybe you're here today and maybe you've never prayed to God. But man, there's a desire in your heart that you're longing and desiring to follow after him. As Jesus would come, if he would stand right here and present before you, if he was audibly speaking to us, friend, I want to tell you exactly what he would say. Number one, he'd say, I love you. I know he would say, I love you. I died for you. I paid the price that you could walk in oneness with God, with the Father. Second thing I believe he would say is this, come, follow me. Come on. Doesn't matter what you're going through right now. Doesn't matter what you're doing, what you did last night, what you did this week. He wouldn't care about that. Listen, all he would care about is you right now in this very moment. And I believe that in this very moment, you would feel the overwhelming love of God manifest through his son, Jesus. When he says, hey, come, follow me. You may question a little bit. You may say, I don't know if I can. But listen, there would be something on the inside that would just be drawn. Can I tell you something? Because of what he did on the cross and because of the Holy Spirit, that same thing is happening right now. All across this room, all across the internet, as you join with us, listen, Jesus is calling. He's saying, come, follow me. What do I do, Pastor? Well, listen. Scripture says that simply we repent of our sins and we believe upon Jesus. Believe in our heart that he died for us, that God raised him from the dead, and that he truly is Lord of our life. You might want to say a prayer like this. Father, thank you for loving me and for sending your son, Jesus, to die on the cross for my sins and raising him from the dead to give me life. Jesus, I repent of my sin and I turn to you. Today, I choose to follow you, Jesus, with all my heart for the rest of my life. And I believe you and declare that you are the leader, the Lord of my life. And I thank you for forgiving me and walking with me from this moment forward. Amen and amen. Friend, listen, if you said that prayer, you believe with all your heart, I believe this with all my heart, that if you pray that prayer by faith, man, you're saved. That prayer is a prayer of faith, of saying, Jesus, I want to follow you. If you did that, I want to just give you a couple of instructions. There's a couple of ways how we can connect with you today. You're here with us this morning. If you have your mobile device, you can go online right there. If you're following on our Bible app, there's a place there that says next steps, or it says even prayer requests. Either one of those, if you click on that, if you click on the next steps, it's going to take you to a form we ask that you fill out. And then on there, choose, today I chose to follow Jesus. And what's going to happen is that's going to connect with you, with us. That's going to send us an email so we'll be able to connect with you. Or you can say on the prayer place, say today in a prayer request, just say, will you pray for me? Today I chose to follow Jesus. But if you're here today, you can do one of those or you can simply do this. We want to pray for you. If that's you today, friend, would you just simply raise your hand and say, today I chose to follow Jesus. Man, we want to walk with you. We want to pray with you. Listen, we want to do three things. We want to connect you to God. We want to connect you to his church. And we want to connect you with other believers. And out of that, we believe God's going to do great and mighty things in your life. Today, if you're looking for a church family, a church home, if you're a guest with us today, man, we welcome you and we'd love for you to be a part of Harvest Time. If you're online, you can join also. We want you to go ahead. You can do that through the Next Step card and connect. Let us know you'd like to know more about the church and we'll begin contact with you. But listen, we pray God's blessing upon you and we believe that the greatest days of your life are still ahead. Amen. Amen. Listen, I want to challenge you this week as you leave from here, man, make a decision to live a life of prayer. And let's see what God does in through our lives. Would you stand with us this morning? This morning we're going to say, I'm going to pray over you, and then we're going to sing one last song, then we'll be dismissed. And I just want to encourage you, continue to pray for us. Be watching online, both on our Facebook and our website. We'll continue to be giving updates as things change, as things progress. But we want to say thank you so much for joining with us this morning. And we're continuing just to pray for you, for your health and your strength as we continue to go through these days of recovery and also getting back as to whatever normal is. But we just want to say thank you for being with us. Lord, thank you, Father.